Hey guys, I recently purchased a massage gun, and in this video I want to talk through how it should be used, as well as the tiny, tiny amount of credible research behind these products. There's been a big jump in the popularity of percussive therapy devices, aka massage guns. Checking Google Trends, this started in summer 2019 and it's been peaking every Christmas. They range in price from about £50 all the way up to £500, and they absolutely vary in quality as well. There's an excellent channel called Before You Buy, where he compares over 30 different massage guns. He produces a top 9, which I've put up on screen now. There are two entries from Bob and Brad, who are physical therapists with a popular YouTube channel. One of their products that didn't make the cut is the C2 massage gun, which I received for free in exchange for product placement. So here I am placing their product in my video. I'm going to start with the massage gun research. If you want to skip this bit, I might have chapters below, otherwise the timestamp you're looking for is here. Okay, so I have 6 studies and 2 literature reviews. Let's go. The first one is 1990. This was the only one I found that wasn't in the last few years. It said vibratory massage. The technology will have come on a lot since then, so we can't really give any weight to the findings. Anyway, subjects performed 3 sets of repeatedly tensing their quadriceps until power output dipped below a certain level. Between sets, they either had 5 minutes rest or 4 minutes percussive massage and 1 minute rest. There was no significant difference in rate of fatigue between the two groups. Jumping right ahead to 2019, 2 groups both did a dynamic warm-up. One of them rests for 5 minutes while the other has percussive therapy on their glutes, hamstrings, quadriceps and calves. No difference in vertical jump height. 2021, 2 groups had their calf strength and flexibility measured. One received 5 minutes of massage with a hypervolt gun, the other just sat still. There were no changes in strength with the massage gun, but a significant increase in range of motion, slightly more than 5 degrees. The authors compared this improvement to what you might expect from conventional massage. Speaking of, in another study, participants did 3 sets of 30-second calf stretches, with half of them doing an additional 60 seconds with a therapy ball. The stretching alone improved range of motion by 3 degrees, while stretching plus massage gave an extra 3 degrees, making 6 degrees in total. So the previous study showed that the massage gun works better than sitting in a chair, but this study shows that there are other ways to get the same result. The final study looked at maximum reps in the bench press without going below a certain bar speed. And across 4 sets, the guys who used the massage gun on their pecs between sets didn't produce any greater force, but did crank out 10% more reps, meaning it helped with muscular endurance. The literature reviews concluded that the percussive therapy is good for increasing short-term range of motion and reduction in muscle soreness, but it does nothing for power output. I did find one paper which was a case study of a Chinese woman who followed up a cycling workout with the use of the massage gun, and she actually gave herself rhabdomyolysis, which is a severe breakdown of muscle tissue and in her case required hospitalization. I expect that the massage gun was used for way more than the recommended 2 minutes per muscle group, but it does illustrate the potential dangers of misuse. Okay, so how to use a massage gun. Luckily, the Bob and Brad one came with a user guide, which I've converted into a few cheat sheets for ease of use. The first is for which head to use. Most massage guns come with 5 or 6 different heads, and it's not immediately obvious what you're meant to do with each of them. Here you can see which head to use and also which level to set it on. So you can see the forked head is only for the spine, while the flat, ball, and cushioned heads are the most versatile. The forked head requires a partner since it's for the middle of your back, and the 2 workarounds I've seen are to either secure the gun to a squat rack with resistance bands, with the prerequisite that you own a squat rack and resistance bands, or the Kickstarter campaign for the monkey mount. Depending on your flexibility, there may be other areas that aren't that easy to both reach and apply the appropriate force. On the subject of force, massage guns have something called a stall force, which is when the gun is going to shut down if you push too hard. That's covered on Before You Buy, and he uses a cushion on top of his scales and tests out each gun, and I did the same with mine. Both my guns came out around 11 kilos, and I've not needed to apply that much force to my body yet, but I can hear it getting close to shutting down when I do my calves or glutes. If you were fixing a knot in your muscle and you needed more pressure, then you could always switch to the bullet head. The second cheat sheet is for the pressure and duration to use the gun, depending on whether you're looking to do pre-workout or mid-workout activation or post-workout recovery. I'll be honest, I didn't even consider using this for my warm-up. I get a sports massage every few months, and I also set aside time each week for foam rolling, and in my head, those were the things this gun was going to replace. Having seen the limited research on pre- and mid-workout use of the gun, it's probably more beneficial to wake up your muscles by some other means, perhaps using quick passes with a foam roller or massage stick, followed by activation drills. I'm putting some activation drills up on screen. These are the popular ones for upper and lower body workouts. These help a lot with the mind-muscle connection. A few years ago, I did a 3-week pull-up and push-up program, and I'm confident that doing activation drills before each workout made a noticeable difference to both muscle size and strength by the end of the program. It seems a lot of effort to bother with the massage gun mid-workout, so that just leaves post-workout. I still do some static stretching followed by the massage gun, using it for 2 minutes per muscle group as per recommendations. Therabody has a full playlist broken up by body part, but I'm just going to demonstrate the ones that I use it for, starting with the lower body. So calves, quads, hamstrings and glutes. I like the flat head for the glutes and I use the ball for the other three. The important point is to move slowly and apply moderate to heavy pressure. It's also very important that the muscle is relaxed while you massage it, so it should feel a bit squidgy to the touch. An alternative to the glutes is a tennis ball or therapy ball. For the quads, hamstrings and calves, you can use the foam roller, but it sometimes lacks the necessary downward pressure. You can really go at your calves with something like PVC pipe, but for simplicity, the gun is actually a decent option. Upper body, again, some stretches. Then here's where it gets a bit awkward to use the gun. You may need to grab the barrel rather than the handle, or if you're lucky, you might have someone around who's willing to help. The general consensus is that a massage gun is a poor substitute for an actual massage from a qualified therapist, because the gun can't tell what's muscle, what's ligament, or get any kind of feedback from contacting your body. However, a massage therapist might cost you £50 an hour, so the massage gun is far more cost effective, which is why I purchased my Renfo. If you haven't bought a massage gun already, there's no evidence that it offers anything different to manual therapy, foam rollers, trigger balls. It is, however, more convenient. You can also apply the right amount of pressure because you're not relying on gravity. And if you stay away from the high-end models, then it doesn't break the bank. If you do own a massage gun and you have any strong opinions for or against them, then please leave your comments below. Thank you for watching.